Welcome to the weekly webcast. Each week, these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living. It is our hope that you will be encouraged and challenged by this message and that you share it with a friend. The devil and his minions have been defeated, but they are still running loose and sin has now tainted the once flawless creation. This week, we will examine how our spiritual effort can and will affect the men and women around us. Peter was operating under the anointing of the Holy Spirit, and a lame man was healed. Ananias and Sapphira wanted to be popular like Barnabas and concocted a lie, and the Holy Spirit ended their lives prematurely. Paul was grieved when a demon-possessed girl began promoting the kingdom of God. The seven sons of Sceva recognized that there was power associated with the name of Jesus, but the situation quickly got out of control when they misappropriated Jesus' name. Most Christians are inwardly focused on health, relational, and/or financial issues, trying to keep some semblance of normalcy while they stem the tide and try to keep their life from falling apart more than it is. We have been transferred from the kingdom of Satan to the kingdom of God. However, you must first take care of your inward needs so you can be useful to God and outwardly focused. This message is entitled, Spiritual Effort. Welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church. Today we're going to be talking about spiritual effort. And before we begin, I would like to open up in prayer. Father God, once again, we're going to read your word. And Father, I just ask that as we do that, that you would just give us discernment, that we would read, not just read English, but read with the understanding that you want us to, that we read with spiritual discernment, that we will grow. And in doing so, we will become more perfect, more complete. And this is my prayer now, in Jesus' name, amen. Now, in the beginning, God created everything perfectly. There was no problems. Sin, however, was something. Sin is an abstract concept. It's not something that's tangible. You see, you talk about things like love, hope, and faith. You can't touch love. You can't touch hope. You can't reach out and grab faith. It's an abstract concept. If we were to talk about chairs and clothes and wood and so forth, these are concepts that we can grab a hold of. We can see, we can touch them, we can interact with them. Now, we can interact with abstract concepts, but it's more hard to do so. Sin is something that's an abstract concept, and yet it tainted God's creation. Here you had something that was flawless, it was perfect, and suddenly it wasn't anymore. It would be like somebody was to, you know, mix together a nice batch of lemonade. And if somebody was to put one drop of urine in there, we would consider that batch to be tainted. You could probably still drink it and not get sick, but you know, you don't really want to. It's disgusting. It's been tainted now. And God views sin the same way. Well, Lucifer was the originator of sin. And so he basically ruined this creation. And God said, okay, well, there was a war in heaven, and Lucifer lost, and then humanity came into being. And humanity was more or less created to prove the righteousness of God. As you read the Bible, we see that God put a tree in the midst of the garden, and he told them not to touch it. It was a temptation. It was something that Satan could use, a tangible thing that Satan could use to tempt Adam and Eve with. If he didn't have something tangible, it wouldn't really be a temptation. You see, everything that is a temptation to us is tangible. Our thoughts, while they may be abstract, they're real in our mind. And Jesus confirmed this when he said, you know, if you think about adultery in your head, it's as if you did the very thing itself, which shows us that our thoughts are real and they carry great power, at least in the spirit world. So humanity is put here on this earth to prove the righteousness of God. And then Satan comes in and he has his chance. And he's able to make Eve fall. And then utilizing Eve, he takes Adam down as well. And so in the end, now you have the two human beings that have been put in this perfect paradise. They've now succumbed to basically the devil's lie and temptation. We're going to pick it up here in Genesis chapter 3, verse 14 and 15. And the Lord God said unto the serpent, because you have done this, you are cursed above all cattle and above every beast of the field. Upon your belly you shall go, and dust shall you eat all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. It shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. This was a prophecy that was something that would take place about 4,000 years going into the future, when kind of like a dog, you know, a little dog nipping at the heel, so to speak, Satan was able to inflict a wound upon Jesus by having him nailed to the cross. But it was temporary because Jesus conquered death. And in doing so, he rose from the grave. And as the prophecy said, he was able to bruise Jesus' heel, but Jesus bruised his head. In a sense, he just, you know, kicked him in the head. Now, if you were to kick somebody in the head and get in a fight with them, you could do great damage to them. If you kick somebody on the backside of their heel, it'll hurt a little bit, but a kick to the head is vastly different. And so what we have here is we had a fulfillment of prophecy. Now we flip over to 1 John chapter 3 and verse 8. And what we have here is, this is John, this is, you know, the good friend of Jesus when he's walking here on this earth. And he says now in verse 8, he that commits sin is of the devil, for the devil sinned from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. You see, that was the purpose of Jesus from the very beginning. Before the creation of mankind, before the creation of the angels, there was a plan that had been set aside. And the New Testament reveals this. In 1 Corinthians, it says that had the princes of this world known this, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. So there was a hidden plan and so forth. And Jesus was the fulfillment of this. And then, so Jesus is victorious. But where does that leave us now? Obviously, the devil and his minions are free and loose here on this earth. This earth is more or less a prison planet. They're confined to this planet. We are confined to this planet. They interact. We're living in the physical realm. They're living in the spiritual realm, and we can interact. We can't necessarily, well, I suppose we could cross over through divination and so forth, but it's a lot easier for them to cross over to our side. 1 Peter 5:8 bears this out. If you just flip backward to that book there. And it tells us that, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary the devil, as a roaring lion, walks about, seeking whom he may devour. The devil is defeated. All the evil spirits and the demons with him, they're defeated as well. But just like an army that's been defeated, they're still tangible. They're still here. They're not locked up. They haven't been bound. They're still walking around free. That's the important concept to understand there. While the devil has been defeated, he's still running loose. And God has not, he's put a stay on this execution. In other words, we know that the devil has been sentenced to the lake of fire, but he's not there yet. And while he's not there yet, he's here on this earth, and he's creating havoc. And you think to yourself, well, where do wars come from? Well, God is not the author of wars. Where does hate come from? God is not the author of hate. Look at all the characteristics that we would have. Look at the fruit of the Spirit. Look at the fruit or the works of the flesh. Look at the characteristics of the devil. Look at the characteristics of God. God is love. The devil is hate. Okay, God likes peace. The devil likes war. They're complete opposites of her. It's light and darkness. They're just two sides of the opposite coin. And when you flip a coin, You can only have one side or the other. I suppose it could land on edge, but that's not really possible. So when you flip a coin, it's always going to come down on one side or the other. It's the same way. This is what Jesus said, no man can serve two masters, for he will either hate the one or love the other, right? This is what we're talking about. It's a concept of, you. If you decide to serve God, the devil is not going to be pleased with this. And if you are in the kingdom of Satan, God is sitting here pulling on you, recruiting you, trying to say, hey, come over to my side. Because the Bible says that God is not willing that any man should perish, but that all should come to repentance. God is not saying, well, I only like Caucasians and to the exclusions of black people. There's a lot of people out there, black people that are very angry that I come across and met. They say, well, you know, this Christian God is, he's the God of the white people. No, he's the God of any color of skin. It doesn't matter if you're male or female. It doesn't matter if you're as Paul said, if you're a bondservant or a free person, it doesn't matter. If you are a human being, God loves you. Now, let's get into the meat of the story now, the spiritual effort that we put in here on this earth. I wrote this on the outline here. If Jesus is the Lord of your life, then you are authorized to use his name in advancing the kingdom of God. Flip over to the Gospel of Luke in chapter 10. What does that mean? Well, a bondservant goes out. A bondservant is somebody who willingly chooses to become a servant of somebody else. The way that it happened 2,000 years ago was that you might have been a slave, and at some point you were set free, but you chose now to continue with that master of your own free will. You became a bond servant. You were more valued than other slaves because you wanted to be there, not because you were being held against your will, not because you were chained, but because now you were more trusted. And so when you went out and you spoke in the name or the authority of the master that you represented. If I went to the marketplace to buy something, it was not my coin, but it was the coin of the master that I brought with him. And it wasn't for me that I was buying, but for the master. Everything that I did was reflecting back upon who my master was. If I behaved well, it was to my master's credit. If I did not behave well and I got into fights or I killed somebody, it was something my master would have to deal with as well. And if Jesus is the Lord of our life, we say Jesus is our Lord and Savior. And, you know, a lot of people, when they talk about salvation, it's this real fuzzy, feel-good thing of, you know, I have a God-shaped hole in my heart. Never mind the fact that that garbage doesn't even found in the Bible. You're a sinner. That's the first and foremost. You're a sinner. And you realize that I need a Savior. And because I need a Savior, I come to Jesus. And I actively make him the Lord of my life. I don't think a lot of Christians think about this. If he is our Lord and Savior, God, you ever seen that bumper sticker that says, God is my co-pilot? God doesn't want to be the co-pilot. God doesn't want us to be the co-pilot either. God wants to be the pilot. We sit in the back. He's driving along, and we're just following what he wants us to do. But if Jesus is the Lord of our life now, if we have made him Lord and Master, then we are authorized to use his name in advancing the kingdom of God. This is what we do during prayer time here, right? We have prayer requests that come in and we say, hey, we are authorized representatives in the kingdom of God. Jesus is our Lord and Master. It doesn't matter where you are in this world, we're going to reach out and connect to you spiritually. The Holy Spirit is going to come out and connect to you, and we're in faith praying for a miracle. Amen. Okay? We're believing for something. Let's read here now in chapter 10. And after these things, the Lord appointed other 70 also and sent them two and two before his face into every city and place whither he himself would come. Then he said unto them, the harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore for the Lord of the harvest, that he would send forth laborers into his harvest. So Jesus said There's a lot of work that needs to be done. What we need is we need people who can go and out and do that work. So he sends them. Now let's go down to verse 17. And the 70 returned again with joy, saying, Lord, even the devils are subject unto us through your name. And he said unto them, now this is past tense, I beheld, not present tense, not future tense, this is past tense, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. Remember the fall? There's a war that was in heaven. Satan is fallen. He's here on this planet. He's a prisoner. This is what Jesus is saying. Behold now, in verse 19, I give unto you power to tread upon serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Notwithstanding in this, rejoice not that the spirits are subject unto you, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven. Now, the power of a name, the name of Jesus. I wrote here on this outline, our spiritual effort can and will affect the men and women around us. That simply means this, that I, as a father, I can affect my wife, my children, immediate family members, and so forth. And in doing so, I can also affect my neighbors, my coworkers, and anybody else that I come in contact with. I also have the ability to affect people that I have never even met. We upheld some people in prayer here today. We've never met them. And yet we can affect spiritual change in their life. We can affect physical things for them. We have the ability to move mountains, as Jesus said. It requires a little bit of faith. But I really want you to look at that sentence there. Our spiritual effort. The amount of effort that we put in, the amount of effort that we take to read the Bible, to pray, and so forth, has a direct effect. So the question is, will you at the end of today be able to lay your head down on the pillow and to say, I did everything that God wanted me to do today? Or will you lay your head down on your pillow tonight and say, I could have done more? What about a week from now? What about at the end of your life? Will you have regrets at the end of your life saying, I wish I could have, it's that whole thing of, I could have done this, I could have done that, I wish I had done this. Or will you simply say, I did everything, I used the resources? That introspective look is something that only each of us can answer for ourselves. I can't answer that for anybody else. You can't answer for me. But our spiritual effort can and will affect everyone around us. Turn to Acts chapter 3. The book of Acts is a running account of the New Testament church following the day of Pentecost. And it lists the good things that happened in the church. It also lists the bad things, the mistakes that happened. But it's a running account. It's a truthful account. And I suspect that if we were all to write our own biographies, how many of us would list everything that happened in our lives, including all the negative things? We would be more than happy to write about all the positive things that happened in our life, the victories that we had and so forth, the good things that happened in our life. How many of us would want to write about our moral failures? Well, probably not. It's not fun to dwell on past failures, but many times we can use them as a learning opportunity so we don't repeat them again. In Acts chapter 3, we find that Peter and John are going to go to the temple. The new fledgling church, they love the temple, they love to go and pray at the temple, and this is what they're doing now. Let's pick it up in verse 1. Now Peter and John went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour, And a certain lame man from his mother's womb was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms of them that entered into the temple, who, seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked an alms. And Peter, fastening his eyes upon him with John, said, "Look on us." And he gave heed unto them, expecting to receive something of them. Then Peter said, "Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." And he took him by the right hand and lifted him up, and immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength. And he, leaping up, stood and walked and entered with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God, and they knew that it was he which sat for alms at the beautiful gate of the temple. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at that which had happened unto him. And as the lame man which was healed held Peter and John, all the people ran unto them in the porch that is called Solomon's, greatly wondering. So what we have here is we find that Peter is basically operating under an anointing. And because he's operating under an anointing, when he speaks, there are instant results. Now, if we're going to be honest, everybody has prayed at some point for a miracle of some kind. Let's talk about just a physical healing. Someone was sick. You prayed the prayer of faith, and nothing happened. You believed, and still nothing happened, and it's kind of discouraging. But does the Bible tell us to give up? No. Now, in this particular instance, it was either going to happen or not happen. This man is lame. His legs are probably like toothpicks because, you know, atrophy of the muscles. He's never really used them. And it says that he just receives strength and he's just running and leaping. He should have been exhausted with leg shaking at the very least, but that's not the account that we find here. What we find is that he receives strength, right? He rises up, he's running, he's praising God. And this is that point. We come back to this sentence. Our spiritual effort can and will affect the men and women around us. The effort that Peter and John had put into following Jesus and becoming a disciple and sticking with him, and even Peter becoming redeemed when, you remember, after the resurrection, Jesus said, "Go and tell the disciples and Peter," right? Peter had been restored. Peter is operating under full power of God here. There was nothing at that point that was impossible for him. He could have walked into a hospital and just cleaned it out, started at the basic and gone to intensive care and had all the intensive care people ripping IVs out and everything and saying, "We're healed, we're out of here, we're leaving." He could have cleaned out a hospital. This is the type of power that we're talking about. And it was because of the spiritual effort when Jesus said to him, "Come and follow me," right? "And I will make you fishers of men." And Jesus said that, but they actually followed him. They made that conscious decision to go and stick with Jesus now. Now it's beginning to bear fruit here in their lives. Now we saw that in Luke chapter 10, that there's obviously there were miracles happening before the cross. There's also miracles happening after the cross here. But if Jesus was Lord, he was Lord before the cross. He was certainly Lord after the cross. There's power associated in the kingdom of God with Jesus. Now, go forward one chapter, and we find the story of Ananias and Sapphira. Ananias and Sapphira, they were this husband and wife, and they wanted recognition. They wanted to be able to have people look at them and say, "Look at this people, look how generous they are." They wanted something because, we're going to find here, Barnabas had come and done something very similar to what they tried to copy, but their motives weren't pure. Let's find this here now in Acts chapter 4 and verse 32. And the multitude of them that believed were of one heart and of one soul. Neither said any of them that aught of the things which he possessed was his own, but they had all things common. And with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. Neither was there any among them that lacked. For as many as were possessors of lands or houses sold them, and brought the prices of the things that were sold, and laid them down at the apostles' feet, and distribution was made unto every man according as he had need. And Joseph, who was by the apostles, was surnamed Barnabas, which is being interpreted the son of consolation, a Levite and of the country of Cyprus, having land, sold it, and brought the money, and laid it at the apostles' feet. So we find here that Barnabas now had a piece of property. He sold it. Let's say he sold it for, $1,000. He took $1,000 and gave it to the apostles. He withheld nothing for himself. Now let's pick this up in chapter 5. But a certain man named Ananias with Sapphira his wife sold a possession and kept back part of the price. His wife also being privy to it and brought a certain part and laid it at the apostles' feet. But Peter said, Ananias, why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Ghost and to keep back part of the price of the land? While it remained, was it not your own? And after it was sold, was it not in your own power? Why have you conceived this thing in your heart? You have not lied unto men, but unto God. Now, stop here for a second and think about this. How did Peter know that Ananias was lying to him? Common sense question, right? Did he know, his business or anything like that? No, it was private. So it's almost like Peter had a secret weapon called the Holy Spirit who just told him instantly, Ananias is lying to you right now. And working off of that knowledge now, Peter immediately begins speaking and saying, Ananias, you're a liar. You're lying to me right now, but more importantly, you are lying to God. Don't you have any respect for God? Ananias is supposed to be a Christian. And yet he thought that somehow he was going to get away with it. And occasionally you find these power displays in the Bible. You find it in the Old Testament with the Israelites when they tried to do things and a prophet would stand up and say, this is not right. You're not supposed to be doing this. And God would provide supernatural knowledge. Well, what we had here is this lie of them wanting to be just like Barnabas, to receive praise and glory and to say, look at this generous couple. Look at what they've given to the church. This is what they wanted, praise and adoration. And because they were willing to lie, God cut their lives short. If you were to go and talk to Ananias and Sapphira, of course they regret what they did. But sometimes we don't get a second chance. You know, grace can be a finicky thing. Grace, once extended to us, we appreciate it. But there's not always grace. In this case, there was no grace. You'll find when you read, Sapphira comes in and Peter asks her, he says, did you sell the land for such and such a price? And she goes, yep. And he says, okay, you're dead too. She got one chance to answer it. That was it. Flip a few chapters over to Acts chapter 16 now. In Acts chapter 16, we have Paul, and he's going kind of through a marketplace, and he's encountering somebody who's a fortune teller, who's speaking under... See, we would go look at fortune tellers today, and they use tarot cards, and they do this, and they read your palm. But a person who's a real fortune teller does not need any of these things because they have a familiar spirit. They have access to the spirit world. This demon is networking with other demons. These other demons now are in contact with other demons that know things about you. They've been around you for your entire life. They've been following you. This is how it works. It's not smoke and mirrors. It's just networking. And in this networking, you think, wow, you're a total stranger. How could you know all this about me? Well, it's not them. It's somebody who whispered in their ear spiritually, and then these demons circled around and connected with other demons who knew you. So it's nothing really but smoke and mirrors. It's a, you know, you're hiding what the true thing is. And now in Acts chapter 16, and we pick it up in verse 16, it says, "And it came to pass, as we went to prayer, a certain damsel possessed with a spirit of divination met us, which brought her masters much gain by soothsaying. The same followed Paul and us, and cried, saying, These men are the servants of the Most High God, which show unto us the way of salvation. And this she did many days. But Paul, being grieved, turned and said to the Spirit, I command you, in the name of Jesus Christ, to come out of her. And he came out of her the same hour." Now, if you're going to run a business, many times you're going to put advertisements out. It might be a flyer, you might advertise in a phone book, you might advertise on websites, whatever it happens to be. If you have a product and you want people to know about it, you must advertise. This girl, speaking by the evil spirit that was speaking in her, was advertising the kingdom of God. To me, this is kind of like a very small animal coming and tugging on a lion's tail, okay? That lion is not going to take that for very long. That lion is going to turn around and just bat that animal and just destroy it. This demon that was speaking through this woman did not realize the fire that he was playing with in dealing with Paul, or any Christian for that matter. Paul just finally just says, that's it, I've had it. And you notice that he doesn't talk to her, he talks to the spirit in her, and he says, get out, and instantly it's gone. Her ability to fortune tell is gone also, okay? She's lost that networking connection to the spirit world, and she can't tell fortunes anymore. I come back to the sentence here on the outline. Our spiritual effort can and will affect change in the men and women around us. Okay? Paul did not have a relationship with that woman, and yet he was not necessarily grieved by her, but by the spirit that was just being antagonistic towards him and following. Never mind the fact that this evil spirit is speaking the truth. Never mind. He's still grieved that this spirit is speaking, and he would basically say, I'm not going to tolerate this. We're in the kingdom of God. This is beneath us. This should not even be happening, right? And he just silenced that thing and took care of it. Now, in the process of doing so, he destroyed the business that these guys had built up, but he also freed her. We don't really know what happened to her afterwards, but I would like to think that something good came out of that. That something good was what freed her of this spiritual bondage, and that she moved on, and that someday we will come up in heaven, and she will say, "Hey, you know that one girl in the book of Acts that's mentioned? Well, that's me. I made it into heaven because of what Paul did for me. He's the one that started me on a road." So sometimes we don't always know what our actions will entail. Last example that we have here, the sons of Sceva. Acts chapter 19. Sometimes now you're going to have people that don't even know Jesus using the name of Jesus. Jesus himself bears this out. If you were to turn to Matthew chapter 7, and it says, Lord, Lord, in your name we've done many wonderful things, and in your name we've cast out demons, and in your name we've done many wonderful works. And what was Jesus' response? Depart from me, I never knew you. You were never born again. That's a harsh thing for him to be able to say. Can you imagine to have that horrible surprise when you stand in front of him one day and he was to say, your name is not written in the book of life. Very nasty surprise. But there are people that recognize that there is power in the name of Jesus. The name of Jesus accomplishes things, just like the bondservant who comes and speaks in the name of his master. Okay? You can impersonate yourself as a follower of Jesus and make people believe that you're a follower of Jesus, and you can have power in the name of Jesus, as we're going to read here, but it doesn't mean that you are with Jesus. Acts chapter 19 and verse 11, it says, special miracles by the hands of Paul, so that from his body were brought unto the sick handkerchiefs or aprons, and the diseases departed from them, and the evil spirits went out of them. You ever thought about that? It's like somebody has like a, you know, like a handkerchief or something, and you were to bring it to somebody, and the anointing on you is so strong, it transfers to an inanimate object, and when that person comes in contact with it, they're instantly healed or instantly delivered from demons. I mean, think of that, the enormous spiritual impact that that is. Then certain of the vagabond Jews, exorcists, took upon them to call over them which had evil spirits in the name of the Lord Jesus, saying, we adjure you by Jesus whom Paul preaches. Notice that they don't say, we adjure you by Jesus. They say, we adjure you by Jesus whom Paul preaches. I've said this before, there are no grandchildren in the kingdom of God. Either you are a son or daughter of God. There are no grandchildren, meaning my children must make a personal decision to make Jesus Lord and Savior of their life. They cannot get into heaven riding on my coattails. They must come in on their own. That's how it is for every single person. And yet these guys right here were riding on Paul's coattails. Okay? We adjure you by Jesus whom Paul preaches. They did not know Jesus. They did not have a relationship with Jesus. They were not born again. They were not in the kingdom of God. None of these things were true. Verse 14. And there were seven sons of one Sceva, a Jew, and chief of the priests, which did so. And the evil spirit answered and said, Jesus I know, and Paul I know, but who are you? Wow. Yeah, you definitely want to be known in the kingdom of Satan. I said this, I heard a story a long time ago. It was a man, probably in the 1800s, he got saved, and he was invited to a prayer meeting that night. And so he sat in the prayer meeting very quietly the whole time. Now, mind you, he's a new believer in Jesus. And so the man says, you know, the friend who invited him said, aren't you going to say something? And so he just said, I want to be known in hell. Amen. Okay, kind of a weird prayer. So they were talking afterwards, and he said, well, why did you pray that? We said, well, I went home today, and I was reading the Bible, and he was relating, you know, to this story, and he said, I want the devil and his demons to know who I am, right? Because what we find here is, as a bondservant, as Jesus is the Lord and Savior of our life, when we come and we command an evil spirit to leave in the name of Jesus, it's not by our authority, it's the authority of the one who stands behind us that things happen. There's no great power in me. There's no great power in you. It's God in us. And the evil spirit says in verse 15, Jesus I know, and Paul I know, but who are you? I don't even know who you are. You're insignificant. And then what happened? And the man in whom the evil spirit was leapt on them and overcame them and prevailed against them so that they fled out of the house naked and wounded. He beat them up. He ripped their clothes off. He gave them the business. I mean, they were bloodied and bruised and hurting and just running for their lives. That's not victory. And this event here, verse 17, was known to all the Jews and Greeks also dwelling at Ephesus, and fear fell on them all, and the name of the Lord Jesus was magnified. And many that believed came and confessed and showed their deeds. Many of them also, which used curious arts, brought their books together and burned them before all men. And they counted the price of them, and they found it 50,000 pieces of silver. So mightily grew the word of God and prevailed. So we have something here now. We're talking about a spiritual effect, right? Of what we can do. But we see something here of where unbelievers had a spiritual effect on the rest of the city. 50,000 pieces of silver, I would imagine, would have been a fortune back in those days. You would be a very, very rich person. multi-millionaire. So many other people were affected by that one incident that God used that to turn other people. Now, come here, the outline. I wrote this. Can you imagine if Jesus had been careless and apathetic during his 3.5 years of ministry? Can you imagine if Jesus had been just, you know, well, I don't really feel like doing any ministry today. I think I'm just going to go sit under a tree. I need some me time. I need some alone time. Okay, we don't find that happening. He wasn't selfish in that sense. Yes, he did have some alone time, but it was, you know, just like everybody else needs. But he didn't take time off. He was ministering the whole time. Jesus comes to the earth. Here he is in God. He's God up in heaven, full of glory. And you say, well, how is that different? Well, if you go forward to the book of Revelation, we have John, who does not recognize his best friend on the earth. You would think that John, who had spent 3.5 years with Jesus, would recognize Jesus when Jesus appears in front of him. And yet John did not recognize him. Why? Because Jesus was in glory. It says that his eyes are like fire, hair as white as snow, feet burnished like liquid brass. His voice is the voice of many waters. His appearance was completely different. Why? Because he's in glory. He's God. He removed that from himself, and he humbled himself, and he became a man. He was the God-man. He was still had a lot of spiritual power, but he didn't take everything that he had in heaven down with him. Flip over to Philippians, and this is what Paul is going to bring out here. Jesus humbled himself, and he basically took the form of the man, and he allowed agents of Satan to abuse him. They abused him verbally. They physically abused him. They did everything that they could against him. He died on the cross. Do you think that he didn't want to come down from that cross and teach those Pharisaical hypocrites that were standing there laughing and mocking at him to say, you know what? I'm just going to rip myself here off the cross. The nails are just going to fly out. I mean, he could have done something. He could have done something. It was so awesome, a power display like you never imagined. Do you think the human part of him wanted to do that? Absolutely. But he didn't. In Philippians chapter 2 and verse 5, it says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself, and became obedient unto death, even the death on the cross. Wherefore God also has highly exalted him, and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven, of things in earth, and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. That's a pretty good summary of what Jesus came to on this earth to do. He put his feelings aside of vengeance and hate toward these people, because believe me, it says that he was in all points tempted like as we were, yet without sin. He felt hate toward these people. He didn't act on it, though. He wanted to, you know, to do something in return, but he didn't. He showed them love. There is no one that's ever going to be able to stand before him one day and say, Jesus, you didn't show me love. You didn't show me any grace. You didn't show me mercy. You struck me down at the, 2,000 years ago. There's no account to that. What we find is that he went about doing good and healing people, preaching the kingdom of God. All the while, Satan and his minions and his human aggressors that were, basically agents of Satan were here on this earth working against him. Now, here on the outline, most Christians are inwardly focused on health. relational, and or financial issues. This is reality. Everybody has health issues, everybody has relational issues, and everybody has financial issues. Now, you may have all three, you might only have one. Praise God if you don't have any of them, but I promise you, you're going to have one of those three at some point in your life. Now, here's the problem. With all the successful preachers that are on television, you know, the ones that are prosperity, the ones that are wearing, you know, the $2,000 suit saying life is great, be positive, you know, this, that, right? They feed you this cotton candy that tastes good, but in the end, you still got to go home. And at home, that's where you got your problems. That's where it's real. All right? That's where you have to deal, you still have to deal with your health issues. You still have relationship issues at home, and you still have to deal with financial issues. You see, sometimes we like to go on vacation, or, you know, if you're younger, you go to like camp for a week, and it's like a bubble. You're living in this bubble, and life is great, right? But eventually, you have to leave that bubble and come back into reality. Sometimes church can be a little bit of a bubble, right? But you always have to leave the bubble and come back. And when you come back, that's when everything comes and hits you full force again. Now, you gave it all to God. You asked God to take care of it, but you still, the reality is it's still there. And so what we're trying to do sometimes is we try to portray a sense of normalcy, like, well, I look normal, right? And you know, meanwhile, inwardly, it's just like the dam is breaking all over the place and you're trying to patch it and you're putting things up and while you're trying to maintain an air of normalcy, right? But this is not real. This is fake. So what do we need to do? Well, we need to be real. We need to say, like it says in the book of James, if any man has, you know, a need, you come before the elders of the church and pray and the prayer of faith shall heal him. Da-da-da-da. Be real, right? This is what Christianity is about. It's about being real. Now, last sentence there in that little paragraph. Living a reactionary lifestyle. Reaction means that you're always reacting to something. You see, if you're playing football and you're playing defense continually, you're not going to score any points because you're always defending. The other team is in charge of the ball, and they're driving the ball down the field. All you're doing is reacting to everything that they do, trying to stop them. Think about this. Was Jesus actionary or reactionary? Now, there was times where he did react, but for the most part, he was doing things and he was simply confounding the kingdom of Satan. Look at the early church. They had a wave of success initially where they simply confounded the devil and he tried to stop. He was reacting continually. And eventually, the devil was able to put up roadblocks. It's like a wave, and he was able to slow the wave down and bring it down. And now the church is kind of like a trickle. We don't want to be a trickle, but this is the reality. The church, for the most part, is a trickle. It needs to be a wave that just comes in and just crashes against the beach. And if you've built something there, it hits that and rolls over it. And another wave comes and hits it. And another wave. My children and I, we went to the beach one time, and we had some shovels, and we found some really large pieces of wood. And being the enterprising dad that I was, I thought, you know, we're going to do something. Let's see if it'll actually stay till tomorrow morning. So we dug holes, and we dug like 3-4 feet deep. We sunk these pieces of wood in, we packed the dirt in, and we made it basically as difficult as possible. But I tell you what, the next day when we came back, that spot was empty. Not a single piece of wood was to be found. Those waves had come in and through systematic battering had broken it down, pushed it over, washed it away, and that's what it was. So which one are you? Are you the wave? Or are you the sand that's getting battered? See, the reactionary lifestyle is someone who lives on the defensive. Flip over to John, the Gospel of John, chapter 10. Jesus said, "The thief comes not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. I am come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly." In fact, there's a number of churches that you see, they call themselves Abundant Life Fellowship. I've never asked them, but I would surmise that this is where they get their name from. Jesus promised us a life, and not just a life, but a more abundant life. The person who's living that reactionary lifestyle, they're not having that abundant life. All you're doing is reacting to this and that and this and that. Whereas we should be the ones that are pushing and so forth and causing Satan to react to us. Flip over to Hebrews chapter 12. Now, Jesus proved that he was willing to basically stand in the gap and intercede for humanity. I want you to imagine a wall. You talk about like the walls of Jerusalem. They were known for being very thick, at least 10 feet thick. High walls, thick walls. Normally, you know, if you think of a fence today, it's a piece of wood that's maybe 3/4 inch thick. Yeah, you can take an axe or something, you can batter through that real easy. You take a cinder block wall, doesn't take much more. Take a good sledgehammer, even if it's filled with cement, you can batter your way through that. But if you were to take a cinder block wall and you were to make it 20 feet thick and, you know, 50 feet high and put rebar in with that, it is going to take quite a while to break through that. Now, we should not have any breaches in our walls, yet we do. So Jesus is the one, I want you to imagine this really thick wall, Jesus is the one that goes and stands in that gap and says, no one is going to pass from here. I'm not going to let anyone through. That is more or less what he did when he came down to the earth and he died on the cross for our sins, is he said, I am here to stand in the gap. I'm going to take the hit. Anybody that comes against me, I will take the hit. You think about this, the salvation message of you have a God-shaped hole in your heart, and only Jesus can come and fill it. All right. Jesus sounds kind of wimpy when you talk about like this way. Let's think of him as a warrior. Let's look back at the Old Testament. You look at throughout the Bible, do we see a wimpy Jesus? No. We see somebody who stood. You could come up, there's a lot of movies out there, a lot of movies that have fighting and war. And we love stories of a hero, you know, somebody who leads, other people rally up against him. But this one person is the one that leads the charge, right? And we identify with that. I mean, everybody loves a hero. Well, in this story, Jesus is the hero. He's the one that led the charge. Everyone in the Garden of Gethsemane deserted him. He continued. He stood there by himself. He took the blow, right? They arrested him. They bound him. They beat him. They pulled his beard out. They whipped him to the point where he was just, you know, from head to toe, bloody mess, right? Torn with nails and glass and pieces. Then they hang him on the cross, but that's not enough. They're going to strike nails into his wrists. Oh, that would hurt. Strike it into his feet. He suffers there for 3 hours, right? He's hanging on that cross. It's a struggle just to breathe. This is what I mean by he took the blow. He stood in the gap on behalf of humanity, right? Jesus, this is why I wrote here on the outline, Jesus proved that he was willing to stand in the gap and intercede for humanity. The cruel hate from Satan was borne solely by Jesus on the cross because he valued us so much. In Hebrews chapter 12, we read this, wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that was set before us. Who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Now, I don't know about you, but if we're going to be real, I'm not necessarily thinking it's a joyful thing to be, you know, approaching a cross that way. It takes an entirely different mindset to say that who for the joy that was set before him. Now, the human part of Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, he says, If it is possible, let this cup be removed from me. If it is possible. Nevertheless, he says, not my will, but thy will be done. And he was talking to Heavenly Father. It was with joy that Jesus came to the earth, because it was a fulfillment of the promise that had been made to Adam 4,000 years previously. He now came, and he was going to destroy the works of the devil. It was a momentous change. I stated this in past. If you were to look at all of human history, from the very beginning to the very end, there's going to be one pivotal point that everybody can look forward to and everybody can look backward to, and that is the cross of Jesus. Everybody in the Old Testament looked forward to the time of the Messiah when he would come, and we all look back to the time when he came. The cross is what unites all the generations of human history. And this is what it means, that who for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross. He despised the shame that came with it. And he is set down today at the right hand of the throne of God. That is our Lord and Savior. That is a victorious Lord and Savior. Turn your outlines over. Some of these things that I've written here are some holdovers now from previous messages. Learning to be patient and to wait upon God regardless of the circumstances, right? We just read that who for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross. Do you think Jesus wanted the cross to be over like that? Just say, let's just get it done with, I'm just going to die for their sins. There was a set time that he had, that God had come up with. He endured the cross. And then he said, when that time had expired, he said, it is finished. He waited. Now, today, as Christians, we know that Jesus is greater than the devil. That means that when we look at the cross and how Jesus now sits at the right hand of God the Father, what should that do to us? 1 John 4:4 says, greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. So, if that is true, if Jesus is our Lord and Savior, and he is now sit down at the right hand of God the Father, what should that do for us? Should we want to be an average Christian? Or should that inspire us to be more? I have read some books by people who were Navy SEALs. And, you know, Navy SEALs, they're known for being very, very tough. One thing that they all say is, we're capable of so much more than we actually think we are, because they are tested to a physical and mental breaking point. That if you were to have a class of 100, maybe 95 quit, just can't take it. They all quit at various stages, but the guys that go through that class, they've hit a breaking point. And they pushed through that, and they didn't allow themselves to stop physically. They didn't allow themselves to mentally stop and just give up and say, you know, I could do it physically, but I just don't want to anymore. That's the mental aspect of it, right? They give up mentally, and they say, I can't do it. And they're overcome by the fact that they're hungry or cold or tired, and they just give into that. Well, this, what we're talking about, is very much applicable to the Christian life. Right? We're physical. We're also mental. Right? Paul says in Ephesians chapter 6, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. Right? And then he goes in and he talks about putting on the whole armor of God. But it's a mindset. Now, what do we do? Well, if Jesus is greater than the devil, he has conquered him, as we read, and he's sitting now at the right hand of God the Father, and if we are followers of Jesus and we're in the kingdom of God, where does that place us? Well, it should place us with a mindset that let's not just be, you know, average Christians. Let's be something more. We have been transferred from the kingdom of Satan to the kingdom of God. quickly turn to Colossians chapter 1. Colossians 1, 9. For this cause we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you, and to desire that you might be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding, that you might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work, and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all might according to his glorious power, unto all patience and longsuffering with joyfulness, giving thanks unto the Father, which has made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, and who has delivered us from the power of darkness, and has translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins. And that simply means that before we can go out and do something, Jesus kind of said this. He said, wait for the promise of the Father, right? Before the day of Pentecost. Don't go out and start preaching. Wait for the promise of the Father. They had the people in the upper room had to wait for the baptism of the Holy Spirit. They had to take care of their inward needs first so they could begin going and ministering outwardly. You see, if in order for you to give something to somebody, you actually have to have something. If I have nothing in my hand, I can't necessarily transfer it to you. I have to have something to give you something. If you're empty spiritually, how can you give something to somebody? So, you know, if you're sick, you need to be made well. If you don't have a body, you can't have a ministry here on this earth, right? And, you know, if your legs don't work, you can't go and run after people. You know, if your heart is weak and you can only take 3 steps, you're going to be very limited as what you can do. Well, what about, you know, when it comes to, you know, our needs? We're not just talking, you know, yes, we're talking our health and relational and financial, but what is it that, you know, we come, we're born again, and then what? Well, we're supposed to grow spiritually, but we have these issues. We got walls, but our walls have holes in them. Well, this is where God comes in. He begins patching them, plugging the holes, right? So that we can have, as the book of Job says, a hedge of protection. I wrote this here on the outline. God's pattern, you'll find this in the Bible, is to make you strong so you can be useful in the kingdom of God. You can't truly be useful if you're weak. It's when you're strong that you can go out and be useful. Then, once we're strong, we can use the resources that God has given us. And we're not just talking about, let's say, money, but God has given us talents, right? God has given us things that we possess only, that we can begin to go use those in the kingdom of God. Because he's made us strong, now we can go out. Let's talk about church for a second. The attitude of many people is that they come to church and they say, I'm going to have someone pray over me because I have a need. And it is real. We have needs. Anybody who says that they don't have a need is lying. But our attitude should also be, what about praying for other people? It's not just about what I need, but what can I give in return? This is the problem, is we find that there's a lot of taking, but not a whole lot of giving. If you were to go and talk in a lot of churches, you would find that 5% of the people do 95% of the work. That's not fair. A lot of people take, they just keep taking, but very little is given. I wrote this on the outline. Jesus didn't just die on the cross for you. He rescued you so you in turn can become a rescuer. The rescuee becomes a rescuer. This is the basis for discipleship. I rescue my children from the kingdom of Satan. I share the gospel with them. They respond to the gospel. They, in turn, grow spiritually, and they go out and share the gospel. This is the basics of discipleship. Now, that's just me family-wise, but it applies to everybody else also. You know, you can have spiritual sons and daughters that are not related to you. You go out and you witness. This is what Jesus did in John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That's what that verse is talking about, that Jesus stood in the gap for us. And because he was willing to stand in the gap, we can now grow strong and we can go out and help rescue people as well. It's a self-perpetuating cycle that has been going for 2,000 years. Now, the dark ages were just that. They were dark because the Church of Jesus grew very dim. But the church didn't die. It continued, despite the devil's best efforts to stamp it out. And we will encounter more and more persecution. There will come a time where you will quote the Bible and you will say, John 14:6, Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes unto the Father but by me. And someone will say, that is hate speech right there. And we will go to jail for John 14:6. You say to yourself, that day will never come. Well, you just wait. The devil's people are very intolerant people. But in the meantime, we do what we can to further the kingdom of God. I wrote this on the outline here. Walking with God is not a sprint. Run the race with endurance. Anybody can run immediately out of the gate and just, you know, run full speed. But can you run with endurance? That's the Christian life. That's what it's about. Be strong in your first week. Be strong a month later. Be strong 6 months later, 5 years later, 10 years later, 30 years later. Be strong. Finish well, right? So that you can stand in front of God and say, I don't have any regrets. I used all the resources you gave me. I did everything that I could. I don't have any regrets. That would be a good way to end it. Now, if you're listening and you've never made Jesus Lord and Savior of your life, I would invite you to do so. It's quite simple. All you have to do is recognize that you're a sinner. The Bible says that, it lays out the Ten Commandments. It says that you don't want, God does not want us to lie. He does not want us to steal. He does not want us to commit adultery. And that simply means that if you have ever lied to someone, even a white lie, stolen something, irrespective of its value, or looked at somebody with lust in your heart, you are guilty of breaking God's commandments. And if you've broken just one, that disqualifies you from heaven. But the good news is that Jesus died on the cross. He loves you, and he came to this earth to give you eternal life. You're going to hear a message here shortly after I'm gone, and it's going to lay out the plan of salvation. I would invite you to prayerfully listen to it, because your eternity is at stake. Where will you spend eternity? You're here on this earth right now. When you leave the earth, where will you go? Will you go to heaven or you go to hell? Will you choose to become a son of God? Will you ride somebody else's coattails or just ignore God completely? The choice is up to you. Father God, I thank you for your word, that we can read it, we can understand it, and that your Holy Spirit gives us insight. And my prayer, God, is that as we leave today, we will continue thinking about it and meditate on it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you'll die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth. And your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people. you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are, you've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person, doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you three questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything, even something insignificant like a paperclip at work? 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all three questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these three questions are but three of God's 10 commandments. Failing just one commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking His commandments. That's why He said we've all sinned and fallen short of His standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5, 7-8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends His love toward us in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see, God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with His shed blood so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that He sent His own Son to pay a debt He did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are three places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of two places, heaven or hell. God did not send His Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through His Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by Me." You see, God offers His love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward Him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, He will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, He will do for you. If you call out to Him, He will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past, and there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All He wants for you is to come to Him. He will help anybody who calls out to Him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, He will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, so act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to Him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that you would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now, and I put my faith in you. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that you paid for my sins on the cross through your shed blood, and that you died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank you for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with you. Help me to be obedient and to walk with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and He has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to Him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with Him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Thorell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever.
You've been listening to the weekly webcast. This message was entitled Spiritual Effort. The devil and his minions have been defeated, but they are still running loose and sin has now tainted the once flawless creation. This week we examined how our spiritual effort can and will affect the men and women around us. Peter was operating under the anointing of the Holy Spirit and a lame man was healed. Ananias and Sapphira wanted to be popular like Barnabas and concocted a lie, and the Holy Spirit ended their lives prematurely.
Paul was grieved when a demon-possessed girl began promoting the kingdom of God. The seven sons of Sceva recognized there was power associated with the name of Jesus, but the situation quickly got out of control when they misappropriated his name. Most Christians are inwardly focused on health, relational, and/or financial issues, trying to keep some semblance of normalcy while they stem the tide and try to keep their life from falling apart more than it is. We have been transferred from the kingdom of Satan to the kingdom of God. However, you must first take care of your inward needs so you can be useful to God and outwardly focused. God's pattern is to make you strong so you can be useful in the kingdom of God. Jesus rescued you so you in turn can become a rescuer. This message is available on CD and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1647. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can read insightful articles, watch or listen to a sermon broadcast, and explore the online store. The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to European American Evangelistic Crusades, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.